Welcome to the Known Victory Church YouTube channel. We are so glad that you found us today. We exist to make Jesus known and to be a place that anyone can call home. If you haven't yet, make sure to subscribe, like, and share these messages so we can truly make Jesus known in our homes, cities, and across the world. We pray that this message impacts you and helps you to grow closer to Jesus.
Thank you. I'm excited again today. Sean said, I'm Dustin. I'm the lead pastor here at Known Victory Church. It's an honor every Sunday to be able to share some of the things that God has on my heart. But what's cool about the series we're in is that it's also not just what's on my heart, it's what's on our heart as a church. Because we've been going through a series called Summer Playlist, and we're going through some of our favorite verses as a church. And I've been loving this because as I've been, your verses have been coming in, it's so interesting how the Bible is so full of absolute incredible truths about who we are and who we serve and what the world is about and how we're supposed to be a light in the world. Like, it's filled with so many verses, and we actually haven't had any two people send in the same verse yet. We had someone send in 8 verses, and then someone sent 1 of those 8, so I don't really count that. But I'm just enjoying this series so much, and I hope that as if I share your verse, I hope that I don't ruin it for you. Someone said that. They're like, if you do my verse, please don't ruin it. I'm like, I'll try not to. It's like, I'm just enjoying it. I'm going to be completely honest with you. I probably slept 1 hour last night. I just couldn't sleep. I was up literally, I saw not every hour. I think I saw every 10 minutes go by on the clock last night. And so this is like the real version of me. So I'm tired. And so I'm gonna share what I feel like God has placed on my heart. And I was praying this morning. I was like, God, please give me strength to preach. Because again, I'm quite tired today, but I'm so excited. And we're going to be reading in Romans chapter 8. And Romans, as Sean said, is an incredible book. It really just lays out the gospel, like what the gospel is and how we're supposed to live and how we're supposed to serve. And it's absolutely incredible. And there's this one of the most famous verses in the Bible. It's searched out 33,000 times a month, this specific verse. And what I find fascinating is the most famous verse is John 3:16, which is searched on the internet or tried to be found 2.1 million times every month. John 3:16. No one sent in John 3:16 yet, which I find so interesting. But anyway, Romans chapter 8, verse 28, and this is what it says. It says, and we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them. This is this verse. And again, it's one of the most searched verses, and it's a verse that we love. It's a verse that a lot of us probably have memorized. Maybe it's in a different translation, but this verse is really something that I think for some of us, in some of our darkest moments, sometimes when we're laying in bed at night, this is kind of was me last night, trying to sleep, like, God, like, work it together for my good. You know what I'm talking about? But sometimes, like, when we're struggling the most, this verse is such an encouragement to us, those of us who follow Jesus, that no matter what we go through, no matter the trials, no matter what it is, God will take those things and turn them for our good. It's an incredible reminder of who he is and who we serve and how incredible our Father and how incredible our God is. And it brings us peace in the middle of chaos, and it's an anchor that oftentimes we hold on to in times of trouble, this incredible verse. And so I want to go through this verse really just statement by statement, word by word, to hopefully bring some insight for all of us to what this is, what this fully means, some of the context behind it. And so we're just going to start with the first part of this where it says, we know. We know. And there's a lot of things we don't know. I don't know if you know this. There's a lot of things I don't know. And for example, I don't know much about anything to do with fixing things. In fact, I think I'm better at breaking things than fixing things. And when something gets broken, thank you. It's like, hey, I'm confident in the fact that I'm not good at working with tools. Like, I'm really poor at it. But whenever I fix something, and I'm talking fix something, like I put a nail in a wall, I'm like, look at me. The man of the house. You know what I'm talking about? Like, look what I did. I saw this comedian, he was talking about how his wife always mows the lawn. And he said, but you better go tell every single neighbor that you want to do this so that I don't look like the husband just sitting at home doing nothing. right? Like, I'm not good at working with my tools. There's a lot of things that I don't know. There's a lot of things that we don't know as humans. I think if we were to look in the world of how much information there is, to be honest, we probably know under 1% of all there is to know in the universe when it comes to know. You know, even the Bible tells us several times of things we don't know. And even just a couple verses early in Romans chapter 8, verse 26, this is what it says. And the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness. For example, we don't know what God wants us to pray for. But the Holy Spirit prays with us with groanings that cannot be expressed in words. Ever felt that way? I don't know how to pray. Sometimes we're so overwhelmed with all the things we're supposed to pray for. We see all the natural disasters and we see the own need in our family and we see the own need in our world, in our own city. And we're like, God, like, I feel overwhelmed with what I'm supposed to pray. I don't know what to pray. How many of we felt that way before? I don't even know what I'm supposed to pray. We don't know all the time. And in Proverbs, this is what it says in Proverbs. Don't brag about tomorrow. Why? Since you don't know what the day will bring. We don't know what the future is going to look like. We don't know what tomorrow might bring. Today, we might be on the mountaintop, but I think we all know that oftentimes the ride from the top of the mountain to the bottom of the valley can happen extremely fast. I don't know if you've ever been to Revelstoke. There's this, the Revelstoke, and it's got this mountain coaster in Revelstoke. I've never done it. Number one, it's expensive. Number two, I might be scared. Would I be scared? I don't know. Because the thing about it is you have the opportunity. Some people in my family rode it. You actually have control of the brakes on this mountain coaster. So you can go as fast or as slow as you want to go. And I know so many people that are like, I'm not going to touch the brakes one time. They're like 2 seconds in, they're like pulling the brakes. Like, it's too fast, right? I was researching it because I thought it was so interesting. You descend 915 feet in about 3 minutes. It's average, 3 minutes. Going about 42 kilometers an hour. Sometimes the ride from the top of the mountain to the bottom of the valley happens extremely fast. We don't know what tomorrow is going to bring, right? We don't know. But it says this. It says, and we know. So he says, we don't know how to pray. We don't know maybe what tomorrow is going to bring. But what we do know, it doesn't say not what we hope will happen. It doesn't say what we guess. It doesn't say not that we pray. It says we know. And we know. And do you know what I think the reality is for some of us? I think we've abandoned what we know based on what we don't know. Right? We've abandoned everything that we know, the truth about who God says we are. We abandoned the hope that we have in him. Why? Because what's in front of us seems so uncertain. The adversity facing us seems so precarious. We're like, I don't know. And so what we do is we base everything on what we don't know, not on what we do know. And we know. We don't know what the future is going to look like. So what we oftentimes we do is we abandon the promise. It says, and we know. We have to not forget. We have to stop forgetting and stop abandoning what we don't know stop abandoning what we know based on what we don't know. If we continue on, it says, we know that God causes everything, right? Sorry, I'm lost here for a minute. Again, I told you I'm so tired. God causes everything. So it says, we know that God causes everything. You know, in life, we all know this. We go through moments and seasons and trials and tribulations and hardships. But what we know is that God causes everything. And if you know in life, maybe you're a science major, there's something called cause and effect. When you do something, you cause something to happen, an effect will happen. Last night, I fell asleep at midnight. I was pumped. Woke up 10 minutes later. The effect was I didn't fall back asleep. And so I'm tired today. Why? Because my sleep was horrible last night. So there's a cause. And in fact, God causes everything. We give our trials. We give everything we go through. We give our joy. We give the mountain. We give the valley. We give it to him. And he is the one, when we place it in his hands, he is the one who actually causes something to happen. This is what it says in Psalm 56. It's powerful. It says, you keep track of all my sorrows. You've collected all my tears in your bottle and recorded each one in your book. Some of us were like, I don't know if it's a bottle. It's more like a fish tank. I could fill an Olympic-sized swimming pool with my tears, right? Imagine he has this room up there in heaven. It's just all these swimming pools filled with our tears. That's where my mind goes. But how many of us feel that way, right? It feels like so many things are hard and so many things are challenging, and it says he keeps track of it all. I think sometimes we feel like God doesn't care. We feel like he knows, but like he couldn't be bothered by little old me, right? Why would God care about what I go through when there's all these other things happening in the world? Why would God care about me? The truth is God cares so deeply about you. He knows everything you go through, and he doesn't just be like, figure it out, right? He meets you there. He cares about you. He doesn't abandon us in it all. He's there with us. He takes it all and he causes. Just like he caused the universe into motion. Just like he caused the sea to part. Just like he closed the mouths of the lions. Just like he gave power to the powerless. Just like he caused the demon to flee. Just like he caused the blind to see. The tomb to be rolled. That same thing, the cause he had there is the same cause he has for us, that whatever is in front of us, he's going to cause something to happen that we can't even comprehend or understand. He causes everything. So when we look at what the cause is, God causes, but what's the effect of this? And it comes out in the next part of the verse, work together. To work together, to build off one another, to create something beautiful, that teamwork makes the dream work. But I think sometimes our teammates, we feel like are all our horrible moments. We're like, that does not make the dream team. That makes a bad team. You know, Beth and I, in our own home, we work together to raise our kids. We work together to create a safe place. We work together as a team. And this is what God does, is he causes everything to work together, not work disunified, but to work together. You know, these words here, work together, in the Greek are this word, I'm going to say it wrong, but synergeo, which is where we get our word synergy from. Now, synergy or synergism is defined as the interaction or cooperation of two or more organizations or substances or other agents to produce a combined effect greater than the sum of their separate effects. Some of you are like, I understand exactly what you said. Some of you are like, that doesn't make any sense. You know, one of the most common ways to understand this is when you look at sodium and chloride. You know, on their own, sodium and chloride, dangerous for us. It's not that they're poisonous for us, but the reality is that we wouldn't be able to eat French fries without them. Y'all ever had an unsalted French fry? It's like, might as well give me a raw potato that you microwaved. It's horrible. Extra salt. That's what happens when you combine them together. See, God has this ability to take the horrible things we go through, to take the pain and to take the trauma, to take the trials, to take it all and put them together to create something healthy and beautiful. And I think it's hard for us to comprehend this. It's hard for us to understand how the things we go through that we absolutely despise are some of the things that actually create the future for us. Things that we go through that we wish we didn't have to, and they're hard. But God has this way of taking it all and turning it into something amazing and beautiful. If we go on and continue, it goes into this next part. God causes everything for the good, to work together for the good. You know what this verse doesn't say? It doesn't say that everything we go through is good. I think sometimes we read it that way. We try and put good in our situation. We're like, God, how is this good? That's not what this is saying. It doesn't say that everything we go through is good. It doesn't even say in this verse, and I wish it did, it doesn't even say that God will keep us from bad things. It doesn't say that. It also doesn't say that God will cause bad things in our life. Right? But it says he will cause everything to work together for our good, for the good. And what is good, right? That's a great definition. And it's a tough question to answer, really. What is good? Like, how do we get to the essence of what good is? But the good talked about here is not ease. It's not comfort. It's not prosperity. It actually comes out in the next verse, in verse 29. It says, for God knew his people in advance, and he chose them to become like his son. That's the good. So that his son would be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And the way that the ESV puts it, I like this. It says, for those whom he foreknew, he also predestined. Why? To be conformed to the image of his son, in order that they might be firstborn among many brothers. You know what the good is? It's for us to look more like Jesus. I think oftentimes I want the good to be more money in my bank account. Sometimes I want it to be so that I can not have to work another day in my life. I can live in paradise. I move in to the beach. And then you realize the beach is expensive. We want the good to be easy. We want the good to be comfortable. But I think all of us know sometimes the good is not comfortable. Sometimes when we're being shaped and molded into becoming more like Jesus, it can be pretty painful. When we have to let go of some of the things we love. We have to let go of some of the things to let Jesus actually work in our life. It says, for the good. The good that's promised to us is to be conformed to the image of his son, to become more like Jesus. That's what good is. You know, our hope is in the creator of the universe and his ability to take everything we go through and produce something beautiful. To work together, to two things that could have been so hard, he can bring them together to create something that actually be healthy for us and can actually create our story and help us help other people. That's the good in this. For making us more loving and more empathetic and more caring and more generous and more faithful, more trusting and more dependent on him, and more peaceful and more gracious. That's the good. You know, God doesn't cause the bad, but he always uses the bad for our good. There's so many moments throughout scripture, and if you read the Bible, moment after moment, some of us were like, God, I want to be a hero of the faith. And then you read their story, you're like, I'm probably okay. Right? Like, imagine you're Daniel, and it's like, now you're actually sleeping with lions this evening. You go to the zoo, and now you're part of the zoo. You know what I'm talking about? Like, you're chilling in the lion cage. I wouldn't want that for me. Or hey, we're gonna go walk around the wall 7 times and we're not gonna fight, we're just gonna make some noise and play some songs. Imagine telling the fellas that. Hey boys, I know you're warriors, we're gonna sing today. Trumpeters, you're in front. Maybe that was like a, like, you know, like, I'm gonna stand at the back, you know? What they go through, it's like, wow, we wanna be heroes of the faith. It's not easy. And I read this verse a few weeks ago, but I want to read it again because it's so much in it and it's so powerful. But Joseph, remember Joseph? That's not a life I would want. Hey, bros, you're going to worship me one day. They're like, no chance. You now live in a pit. Now you're a slave. Now you're being falsely accused. Now you're thrown in prison. Now the people you thought would help you get out, I've forgotten about you. Lonely. And then he comes face to face with his brothers after his father has passed away. His brothers are scared for their lives, right? Because they remember what they did to their own brother. They remember what they had done to their father. Their father was weeping. He thought he lost his son. He didn't realize he was still alive. They brought back the bloody cloak. And this is what he says when his brothers say, what are you going to do with us, basically? He says this, you intended to harm me, but God intended it all for good. He brought me to this position so that I could save the lives of many people. You know, sometimes we are brought into a position to save lives of other people. that the things you go through, as horrific and as horrible and how as painful as they are, let that be a story to share and help other people. There's so much power when we come together in our brokenness and share our stories. Share our stories of the things we've gone through, and we can come together and be there for one another in our hardest moments. It says you intended it for evil, but I intended it. God intended it for good. You intended to harm me, but the harm actually brought life to other people. So then the question, last kind of thing we go through is, who does God do this for? Right? Who does God do this for? Well, the answer is of those who love God and are called according to his purpose. The answer is clear. He does it for those of us who love Jesus, those of us who love God and who are called by him. In other words, those of us who have trusted God with our lives, those of us who call ourselves believers, those of us who follow Jesus, this is a promise from God for us, that he'll take our mess and turn it into a masterpiece. That he'll take the very things that poisoned us, that tried to destroy us, and turn it into our message of hope and restoration. Once we follow Jesus, we can't expect our lives to become perfect. We can't expect them to become easy. In fact, I think for a lot of us, when we've given our lives to Jesus, it hasn't become harder because we have the kind of someone going alongside of us, but it becomes difficult because there's something sometimes people don't want a relationship with us anymore, and it can be really, really painful. But there's so much beauty in following Jesus. And so some of us, we think that once we give our lives to Jesus, everything will become easier, that our life will become a cakewalk, that our business will start to thrive, and that our health will become perfect, and our family will stop fighting, and our kids will start sleeping. We think sometimes that's what's gonna happen. But the truth is, sometimes life gets hard. You know, of course, God is our protector. He's our healer. He's our savior. Of course he is. And he loves you and he wants what's best for you and he'll fight for you, of course. You know, I'm gonna invite up our piano player, our Prince. It's nice to have Prince back. You know, God is our protector. God is our healer. And we can take hope. We can take courage that our God, our friend, is taking all of it, everything, and causing it to work together for our good to make us more like Jesus. You know, Jesus, when the story, when he went to the cross, it's one of the most painful moments, you know, really that I've, you know, like seen, like Jesus, like, going instead of me, what I deserved, he took it for me. And that moment of, to be honest, and if you were there, it would have, especially as a disciple, you would have been like, wow, this is what a complete waste of 3 years of my life. The guy I thought was our savior, the guy who walked on water, well, now he's getting carried to a grave. But we all know the end of the story. That's not the end of the story. It's from that moment is actually how we find the freedom and restoration and the forgiveness that we desperately need. That it turned that dark moment into one of the most amazing messages of hope. The most amazing message of hope. The fact that Jesus took the cross, an image of terror, an image of torture, an image of humiliation, and he turned it into a message of hope, an image of hope. I don't know how many people have walking around with cross necklaces or cross tattoos. It's turned into a message of hope. And you know, Jesus will take us, broken people, and he can do the same. That our story now, rather than it being a story that only speaks of pain, now we can share our story that's filled with hope and that can share some with somebody else and impact somebody else's life. We can stand in the midst of adversity, in the midst of darkness, and in the midst of pain with our heads held high, knowing that God is fighting with us. And I want to end with the story of a guy named Jim Elliot. You probably know, maybe you know who this guy is. He was an evangelist who lost his life. He's 28 years old. He lost his life. And I didn't realize how young he was when I started researching. 28 years old, he had been married. I think it was like just 2 years. He had a daughter who was 10 months old. He lost his life while he was sharing Jesus with the Aka people in Ecuador, the tribe there. And you may know the story, but Jim Elliot had heard about the Aka people, an unreached tribe in Ecuador, and his desire was to tell them about Jesus. And that's what he did. They moved to Ecuador, and the story goes, from what I understand, they spent 6 months trying to learn language, trying to learn Spanish so they could hopefully try and reach these people. And they started learning some of their language with someone who had ran away from the tribe. They started learning some of their phrases, and they were preparing to share Jesus with this tribe. They arrived, they had a plane, they arrived, and they started to make contact with the people using their basic phrases that they had learned, and they shared a meal with a few of them, just three of them. And then the story goes is that as they were waiting for more to arrive one day, they were met face to face with some of the Aka people with their spears drawn, five of them there. It says that Jim Elliot had reached for his gun, which was in his pocket, and he had to decide instantly if he should use it in this moment, right, for safety. But it says he knew he couldn't. So each of the missionaries had promised that they would not kill any of them who did not know Jesus yet. They wouldn't do it to save their own life, knowing that they still needed to meet Jesus. And within seconds, the Aka warriors threw their spears, killing all the missionaries. There's five of them there. And of course, the story, if you remember it, I don't. I wasn't alive. This is a story of tragedy. But in some ways, the story, the outcome was expected. They had heard the stories. People who had come in contact, most of them didn't make it out alive with these people. Again, Jim Elliot, he was married to a woman named Elizabeth, and they had a 10-month-old baby named Valerie. You know, this moment that we look back on is challenging and hard and made waves across the world, but it's not the end of the story. It says in less than 2 years, Jim's wife, Elizabeth Elliot, and their daughter, Valerie, and Rachel Saint, one of the other missionaries' sister, were able to move into their village 2 years later. And from this, many of these people gave their lives to Jesus. They became Christians. They started following Jesus. It says now they're a friendly tribe, and the missionaries, including one of the guy's sons, apparently still lives there today amongst these people. There's a book, I haven't read it, but there's this book that she wrote, Elizabeth wrote, kind of about the story, called Shadow of the Almighty. And there's this quote that Jim Elliot had, and I find it so fascinating and so important. It says, "Lord, make my way prosperous, not that I achieve high station, but that my life will be an exhibit to the value of knowing God." That that's the good. To be more like Jesus. That knowing God can change things from the inside out. And I find it so interesting. I'd heard the story and I'd heard, you know, a lot of these, you know, these people living in the tribe, they're no longer, you know, they have passed away. But you know, imagine Jim Elliot's up in heaven celebrating the fact that these people are there with him. These people who had taken his life, he's now celebrating with them. And I think in his mind, and I don't know for sure, it's all worth it. It's all about knowing and becoming more like Jesus. Everything we go through, we have to put it into his hands. And he molds it and he shapes it into something so beautiful and so impactful that our wounds become scars and our scars tell stories and our stories have power. We find the healing. I want to encourage you, whatever you're going through, find healing. Give it to Jesus. I know that for some of us, what we've gone through is so horrific. And the thing is, nobody knows. We've never shared the stories of when we were kids. And there was abuse, Some of us, we've never shared the stories of the painful moments. We've never shared hardest things. We go talk to somebody. Share your story. And you might fill up a swimming pool with your tears. And that's okay. Sometimes I pretend to be tough. I cry more than Beth. I was watching a movie with Jane the other day. And I'd seen it before. And I'm sitting there as Jane's watching this movie. I'm literally crying. As it's about memories that are disappearing. And I'm just crying as I'm like holding my baby. A true story. Whatever you're going through, share it with somebody. Find the healing you need. You don't have to go through it by yourself. And that's how the healing process starts. That our wounds can become our scars, and our scars can become our stories, and our stories can have the power to help other people. We have to take courage that our lives are in the hands of the author of creation. He's the one shaping, he's the one molding, he's taking the broken pieces. He's making it whole, us whole again. It might be painful, but we will come out on the other side with prosperity in the same sense that Jim Elliot knew, and knowing God is the best and most prosperous place we can live. We can never forget. We have to know and never forget that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love him and are called according to his purpose. You know, our takeaway today is so profound. It's the verse. We know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them. I want to pray for us today, and then we're going to kind of close with a song. We're going to celebrate together. We're going to sing the song Freedom again. That's the freedom we find when we give our lives to Jesus. And so I want to pray. I want to encourage you just to stand with us, and we're going to pray to close today. First of all, God, help us never forget. Help us know. Help us be aware. Never forget that you cause everything to work together. Not just some of it. Not just the parts we like. Not just the hard parts, but all of it. You take it all and you work it together. Are good. God, help us be there for one another too. That those of us may be struggling alone, God, help us find courage to share our story. Help us find courage to be there for one another. And God, help us keep our eyes on you. And God, we pray, God, shape us, mold us to become more like Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen.